Here we are, living in the moment. And here we are, dreaming in the open. Now look around, isn't this a new day? Make a move, doing things a new way. A new way. 'Cause this is our world. This is our time. These are our plans. We're gonna let them shine.
I'm Dr. Jayachandra, Department of Oral Medicine Radiology, Kerala Government Medical Hospital.
Everything is getting recorded, right?
This gives me a proud moment and being in dental professions. It provided opportunity to serve for the people who suffer from oral dental diseases. And also, it's given me a good opportunity to bring the medical professionals, dental professionals. Oral health is integral part of dental health. And it is an opportunity to serve as well as create awareness to oral and health problem to the society. Thank you very much.
As oral diagnosticians, through early diagnosis and intervention, help save lives and improving the quality of life of patients. We are honored to be in this field of work, which gives purpose to our lives.
Thank you.
Hello everyone, I am Dr. Ashwin Zavadekar. I am very fortunate, happy and proud to be a student, teacher and a practitioner of pediatric and preventive dentistry. My profession gives me an immense opportunity to help children eat well, breathe well, sleep well, grow well, play sports safely and have an overall good quality of life.
Hello everyone, I am Dr. Hani Gurbakshani Kalyani from Nagpur, Maharashtra. I am a practicing orthodontist here. If you begin to ask me why am I proud of my profession, why am I proud of dentistry, it's because I bring about correction of the smiles. I give happy faces to a lot many people. Also, there's a slight change which dentistry has brought in my life. Instead of focusing on people's eyes, the way they talk, the way they do their hair, the way they dress up, I only focus on their teeth. So my only focus when I meet somebody new is on their malalignment and the malocclusion. So that's what dentistry has done to me.
Good morning, friends. I'm Dr. MGS Prasad. Happy Dentist Day to all of you. Dentistry is my prime profession wherein I do everything. Whatever success I am today, I really owe it to the dentistry. Dentistry has given me bread, butter and also cream. So you know what dentistry has given. Yeah. So we are one of the white collar professions where we deal with patients in all aspects. Physically, emotionally, psychologically, we treat the patient. Happy Dentistry.
Hello and welcome to a very warm welcome to all of you who have come online today to celebrate National Dentist Day. It's a very momentous day for all of us as we celebrate it this year after a pandemic. And through the pandemic, we have lost a lot and learned a lot to live with such kind of infection control and stuff like that. Today it is a wonderful day, and we have experts on some very important topics speaking today. And I would like to welcome the office bearers of IDA and Karnataka State Dental Council to this session. Firstly, I would welcome all the speakers who have come here. Dr. Venkatesh sir and Dr. Shukrat is online already. I welcome Dr. Pavan, who is going to join us shortly. In the office bearers list, we were supposed to have Dr. Sudhindra, who is the president of Karnataka State Dental Council, Karnataka State branch of IDA. Unfortunately, due to some technical glitch, he could not join. Shortly, he will join us and he will be addressing all of us. But before that, I request Dr. Ranganath sir to speak a few words and provide his wishes to all of us. So Dr. Ranganath sir is a very famous periodontist and a very popular teacher. He is the president of our Karnataka State Dental Council. We are glad to have him here, sir. Over to you, sir. We couldn't hear him.
Yeah, can you hear?
Yeah, now we can hear him. Yes, sir.
Yeah. Thank you, Raymond, for giving me an opportunity to speak on this particular day, National Dentist Day. We can call it as all the National Dentist Days we used to celebrate previously along the line 3 years back on this particular day on 6th of March. Now we do celebrate in India National Dentist Day on 24th December. So on the birth anniversary of Dr. R. Ahmed sir. So that's what we are doing it as an idea, and all the dentists in India, we are celebrating on 24th. So anyway, we are on behalf of, since we were celebrating previously, again, I once again wish everyone happy Dentist Day. I don't want to take much time because there are eminent speakers who are going to give a lot of information on how to handle cardiology cases or pulmonary cases in our dental field. We all know that there are many cases where we come across, we diagnose early than any problems, and when we are treating, it's quite difficult for us to handle those cases because they're all interrelated. So they both Dr. Venkatesh and Dr. Pavan sir will highlight on all these things, how to handle cases in our dental fraternity, because we are not well versed in handling cases which are under these two conditions. So I congratulate the Dental Reach, Dr. Raven, Bangalore branch, state branch for doing this excellent program on this particular day. Now I would like to say one thing. What IDEA is doing for us is, I think we started with keeping the registration process through all IDEA branch has taken that initiative. I thank each and every member of an IDEA of Bangalore branch for helping me through our association and council to make sure that every dentist can easily simplify the registration process of KPME. Previously, just 2-3 days back, we have started for ARB. Slowly next week, we'll start with pollution board. Within couple of months, all the dentists will be registered under KPME. So in a very simplified manner, all of us are in one umbrella so that no one will have to face any problem. We as a team from IDEA Bangalore branch always will try to do a good work. I thank Raymond, and he's such a lovely person, and the entire team of IDEA, what they have taken initiative to do all these things. I once again congratulate both IDEA and Dental Reach for doing such an excellent program. Thank you for allowing me to give me an opportunity to speak.
Thank you for always being from front and helping us out in all our issues. Without much ado, I will go ahead to the next stage, which is the actual stage of this webinar. We have with us a very eminent personality, not just as a doctor, but as a human being. I had a wonderful opportunity of listening to Dr. Venkatesh just before this lockdown was opened up, and I was always yearning to hear more and more of him. If I start introducing him, I should use probably the whole of the time that has been allocated today just to introduce him. But I'll go very briefly through his resume and introduce you to him. Dr. S. Venkatesh is a lead interventional cardiologist at Aster RV Hospital, located at JP Nagar, Bangalore. He was earlier the senior interventional cardiologist and head of the Department of Cardiology at Fortis Hospital, Banerghatta. Formerly, he was the unit chief of cardiology and assistant professor at Kasturba Medical College, Mangalore. After completing his MBBS from Dr. B.R. Ambedkar Medical College, Bangalore in 1992, Dr. S. Venkatesh went on to complete his MD in internal medicine from the prestigious PGI Chandigarh, where he was the batch topper and won the first order medal. He completed his DM in cardiology from PGI Chandigarh in 2001. He has been working, he started working as an assistant interventional cardiologist at Fortis Hospital, Mohali. From there on, he was a cardiology assistant professor, as I told, in Kasturba Medical College, Bangalore. He has also worked at Wockhardt Heart Institute, Bangalore between 2004 and 2006. Prior to joining our hospital, that is Astra RV Hospital, he was head of the department and senior interventional cardiologist at Fortis Hospital, Bangalore. I have a very old pro forma of his, actually, I think, which says done only 15,000 diagnostic visualization. He has done much more of them, and he has actually done more than thousands of interventional procedures in catheterization laboratory. He is proficient in diagnostic coronary, peripheral and cerebral and congenital catheterization. His area of expertise is coronary angioplasties, including primary and complex coronary interventions such as left coronary artery, coronary bifurcations, and he has successfully performed percutaneous, mitral, aortic, and pulmonary valvuloplasty. We welcome you all, sir, to once again address us and enthrall us with your knowledge that you have. Sir, we are not able to hear you, sir. Unmute.
Thank you very much, Dr. Raven, for your kind words. And first off, let me congratulate all the dentists who are gathered here on this prestigious day for you. Happy National Dentist Day. I just heard that there is another Dentist Day awaiting you at the end of this year, but then today is a celebration, so happy Dentist Day to you all. And I thank the Karnataka State Branch of Dental Council as well as the IDA for having me here. Now, today morning, I was talking to one of my friends who's a dentist, happens to be a very close friend, and I told him that I'm giving a lecture on heart diseases or heart patients who come to dentists and vice versa. And I asked him to join today if possible. He said, I'm not coming because I'm scared of cardiologists. I didn't tell him, but let me confess that more than dentists being scared of cardiologists, I think at least one cardiologist is scared of dentists. That sound, when that whirring sound of that drill goes into the tooth, I think it really shivers you up. So that's one of the quirks of medicine. I think you interact with other professions, and then of course there is so much of collaboration that happens to help patients. I think dentistry and cardiology or cardiac surgery are quite closely related. Various reasons. Dentists send patients to cardiologists for problems before procedures, and cardiologists send our patients to you before our procedures. There is also some there is also some theory that or probably some research that shows that some of the organisms which are there in the oral cavity can lead to inflammation, and which leads to ischemic heart disease and all that. Even without going there, I think there is a day-to-day interaction which is very much active between dentistry and cardiology. So we will today focus on some of these issues. I think the main practical issues which bother dentists is when a cardiac patient comes, the safety of dental procedures in cardiac patients, the question of antiplatelet or anticoagulant drug which the patients are taking, and thirdly, what about infective endocarditis? I think these are uppermost on your mind when a cardiac patient comes to you. And when a dental patient comes to us, or if we have a cardiac patient who has dental issues, we are again worried about some of these things, especially when we are trying to perform cardiac surgery. We are worried about the caries and their apical infection or periodontitis and all that stuff. So I think we'll try to quickly cover these. I'll try to keep this talking part a little less so that we can have questions, and I would request somebody to read out the questions if there are any after my brief speech. So I think the commonest problem which dentists face when patients go to them is patients who have hypertension and heart disease. How do we deal with these patients is very common. So especially if a patient's blood pressure is very high, there are complications that can happen while the patient is on a dental chair. And especially if these dentistry practices are not inside large hospitals where immediate help is not at hand, I think it can cause a cause of concern. So I think it is very easy to handle. There are only two kinds of situations here, whether a patient's blood pressure is well controlled or not well controlled. If a patient's blood pressure is well controlled according to the patient's records, and of course in a dental practice, if there is a blood pressure apparatus and if we are able to check the blood pressure is not too high, then I think one can go ahead and do the dental procedure, whatever it may be. On the other hand, if there is uncontrolled hypertension, it may always be a good idea to make sure the blood pressure is well controlled. We know that uncontrolled and accelerated hypertension, very high blood pressure, during any kind of procedure can trigger off hypertensive crisis or hypertensive urgencies, meaning which patient could develop heart failure, breathlessness, sometimes even brain hemorrhage and all that. So extremely high blood pressure, a very uncontrolled blood pressure is something one needs to be a little cautious about. But reasonably well-controlled blood pressure should not deter us from going ahead with whatever procedure the patient is on. One of the things I think we must insist on is that on the day of the procedure, especially if the patient is asked to be nil orally, we must ask the patient to take the antihypertensive medicine with a few sips of water so that withdrawal of some of these medicines like beta blockers or clonidine can lead to rebound hypertension and tachycardia, and those can be alarming during the procedure. So therefore, please tell your patients not to withhold their medicines, the antihypertensive medicines, on the day of the dental procedure itself. So other than that, hypertension should not cause much of a problem. As far as heart disease is concerned, there are patients who have ischemic heart disease, especially if they are not stable, if they have occasional chest pains, or patients of arrhythmias whose pulse is irregular, then dental procedures can cause a little bit of an issue. If there is a dental procedure going on because of the anxiety of the procedure, there is sympathetic stimulation, because of which if there is poorly controlled angina, the patient can have an anginal episode. The patient can develop chest pain while being in the dental clinic. So therefore, a history of whether a patient has a heart disease, is the heart disease under control, has it been well treated, does the patient experience any cardiac symptoms during their ordinary activity, this history is very, very important. If there is a suspicion that the patient's symptoms may not be very well controlled, it may be worth for the patient to go back to the physician or a cardiologist and make sure that these symptoms are not dangerous, and also make sure that these symptoms, if they are not innocuous, to be well controlled so that your procedure becomes uneventful. In the odd event that if there is a patient on the dental chair, is a known cardiac patient, has ischemic heart disease and develops angina, please remember that angina most often presents as central chest pain. Sometimes there is a best thing would be to prop up the because by reducing the venous return to the heart, the preload to the heart is reduced, and that if we have a tablet of nitroglycerine, common names like sorbitrate or isordil are there. If they can be put under the tongue, the patient's symptoms may settle down. And if the patient's symptoms settle down very well, the procedure can continue. But if, however, if the patient's symptoms don't settle down, the angina continues, it may be a good idea to immediately send the patient to a nearby cardiac center, because sometimes these patients can even have myocardial infarction. Well, I'm trying to be trying to tell you how to be careful, but these are not common scenarios. Even well-established cardiac patients who are on treatment, it is very rare for us to see a patient from coming from a dental clinic with ongoing ischemia or a heart attack. So while this is a rare event, we must be prepared. That is all I'm saying. So look out for symptoms in a patient before you take them up. If the symptoms are uncontrolled, send them back to the physician or cardiologist. If the symptoms are under control, check the blood pressure and go ahead and do the procedure. If there is a discomfort or chest pain during the procedure, try and give a nitroglycerin tablet. And if it doesn't settle down, send them to the hospital. I think this is the algorithm for cardiac patients with ischemic heart disease and off and on angina. The other patients who can be having a problem is arrhythmia patients. When they become anxious, sometimes their arrhythmias get triggered off. This could be a supraventricular tachycardia or atrial fibrillation. If the patient is asymptomatic, your procedure can go on. But if the patients are having a lot of symptoms, I think it's best to terminate the procedure and send them to a nearby cardiac center. Now, both of these patients, the ischemic heart disease as well as patients with common arrhythmias, sometimes do not tolerate the epinephrine or adrenaline in the local anesthesia very well. So if we are using a 1% or 2% lignocaine, then there should be no problem. The newer local anesthetics, which are more concentrated, sometimes can cause cardiac depression. But more importantly, the adrenaline which is there in the lignocaine. If we are using 1:80,000 or 1:1 lakh preparation, we can safely give up to 2 or even 3 mL of the local anesthetic in one sitting. That should not really cause a problem, even with patients with mildly controlled angina or somebody who is having off and on arrhythmias. But if we are giving a larger dose than that, maybe more than 3 ml of this, one needs to be a little cautious. So if there are multiple, for example, teeth. All right. So I'll start once again with the issue of the antiplatelet therapy, which we spoke about. So there are four different antiplatelet drugs which patients of myocardial infarction, stroke, stents, or a bypass surgery could be on. They could be on aspirin, clopidogrel, prasugrel, or ticagrelor. So these are the common antiplatelet medicines which patients of heart disease and stroke are on. And we see a common request from the dental practices to ask us to stop these medicines before a dental procedure. Now, there are two things here. One is that what kind of a procedure are we looking at? If the procedure is something like scaling or cleaning the teeth, root canal therapy, where the amount of bleeding is extremely low, I don't think we even need to clear these patients for these procedures. I think you could go ahead with impunity without a fear of major bleeding at all. Even when it comes to dental extractions, I think the American Dental Association is very clear that the risk of stopping antiplatelet therapy in these patients may be more than the actual bleeding, because bleeding can always be controlled locally with local measures like pressure for some time or even a small stitch. I think the blood bleeding can be controlled. So it's very rare to have torrential bleeding from a dental extraction, because it's the site is very small and the arteries, arterioles involved are very small. Yet, when there are slightly more complicated procedures like cutting open of some of the wisdom teeth or some maxillofacial surgery being done, then in that case, stopping antiplatelet therapy becomes a necessity. Then we say if it is aspirin, maybe 3 to 5 days. If the other drugs, the clopidogrel, prasugrel, or ticagrelor, we advise them to stop for 5 days if it is safe. Patients who have had stents in the last few months, we should be very careful. It is dangerous for a patient who has had an angioplasty with stent for 3 months to stop the antiplatelet therapy. Therefore, it is always a good idea to ask if the patient has gone through any procedure. Without confirming that, if we just ask, the patient can develop a major complication, then it becomes a you know, issue for the patient as well as for the practitioner because of medical legal issues. Therefore, if at all an antiplatelet therapy has to be stopped without a consultation of a cardiologist or a physician, you could do it after 1 year of a myocardial infarction or 1 year of an angioplasty. But before that, especially if it is less than 6 months, it may be a good idea for us to go back to the physician or a cardiologist and take the necessary approvals for stopping these antiplatelet therapy. If for minor procedures, including some simple dental extractions, stopping antiplatelet therapy may not be even required. The other problem is anticoagulation. That is, patients who are on prosthetic valves, who have clots somewhere, for example, patients who have had a pulmonary embolism, etc. There is a possibility that such patients are on oral anticoagulants. The oral anticoagulants which are used commonly in cardiac patients are warfarin, acinocumarol, or commonly termed as acitrom. Then there are newer oral anticoagulations, what are called as direct oral anticoagulants. These are the drugs called dabigatran, apixaban, and rivaroxaban, which are available in India. Now, these are far more powerful than the antiplatelet drugs, and there is always a concern that whether the bleeding will be more. Again, if you look at guidelines from various international societies, in patients who have serious clotting issues, like those who are on prosthetic valves, controlled by local measures, which all of you are very well aware of, you know, use of tranexamic acid or local pressure or local sutures, cautery, etc. On the other hand, if the risk of bleeding is very high in some patients, for example, patients who are very old, patients who are going to have more extensive procedures, or those patients who have chronic kidney disease in which bleeding chances are high, in these cases, it may be a good idea to consult a cardiologist to see what can be done about the oral anticoagulation. Commonly, what we do in patients who are on oral anticoagulation is we stop the oral anticoagulation for a period of time, put the patient on injectable, that is heparin or low molecular weight heparin, for some time. 24 hours before the procedure, we stop the heparin, and then the procedure is conducted. And later during the evening or the next day, we restart the oral anticoagulation. So this transition is done from oral to injectable anticoagulation in patients who it is absolutely not safe to stop oral anticoagulation for too long, but at the same time has a patient who is on oral anticoagulation, it is best for the patient to go back to the cardiologist or a physician to see how important it is for them to continue the oral anticoagulation during the process, and thereby take a decision as to whether to stop, whether to transition with an injectable, or whether not to stop. So that can be done. And the last important question which comes for patients who come to dentistry practices is about infectoendocarditis. We know that some of the cardiac patients are at very high risk of infective endocarditis. It is not very clear because, whether any dental procedures can give rise to this infective endocarditis. There is actually no research proof that dental procedures, including dental extractions, can actually cause infective endocarditis. What has happened in the literature in the past 5 decades is that we have looked at bacteremia as a consequence of dental procedure. Most of the studies have looked at what kind of bacteremia happens if there is a certain kind of oral procedure. And based on the kind of bacteremia that happens, we deem that these oral procedures are risky. There is no direct evidence that oral procedures can give rise to infective endocarditis, though, you know, anecdotally we may come across some of these things, you know, one must remember that even simple act like brushing our teeth can give rise to bacteremia. So bacteremia alone is not sufficient for causing infective endocarditis. Yet the guidelines do say that when we have a dental procedure, in some patients who are at high risk for infective endocarditis, we must give prophylactic antibiotics. So some of the things which are important is indiscriminate use of antibiotics should not be undertaken, especially if patient has no heart disease, because we all know that indiscriminate use of antibiotics has their effects. One is there could be antibiotic allergy. For example, if somebody is penicillin allergic and we give them something like a cephalosporin, there could be anaphylactic reactions. You could have patients with antibiotic resistance. Bacteria with antibiotic resistance can develop with indiscriminate use of antibiotics. Therefore, it is recommended that unnecessarily antibiotics are not used. However, where dental procedures are deemed to be of high risk for infective endocarditis. And what are these cases? Patients with prosthetic heart valves of any kind. Second, patients with cyanotic congenital heart diseases like Eisenmenger syndrome or tetralogy of Fallot. So these are at very high risk of developing infective endocarditis. Patients who have already had endocarditis in the past for whatever reason. Patients with, in India, we see a lot of rheumatic heart disease patients with mitral valve disease or aortic valve disease. Again, these VSD closure using devices or patches for the first 6 months, they are at a high risk of infective endocarditis during dental procedures. There are some patients with congenital heart disease who have shunts inside. These are tubes technically, or something called as baffles. These are tunnels which are created inside the heart. If these are done, then again for life, these people are at high risk of infective endocarditis. So these patients who are at high risk of infective endocarditis should receive prophylactic antibiotics. The trick about prophylactic antibiotics for infective endocarditis, for prevention of infective endocarditis, is that we have to give these drugs at fairly high doses, because the MIC, the minimum inhibitory concentration, has to be high enough to prevent bacteremia seeding into the valves. So therefore, the usual practice of giving antibiotics for 3 or 4 days before, like in a normal patient with poor oral hygiene, that may not work for prevention of infective endocarditis. Therefore, some of the other drugs are used, and commonly used drug is amoxicillin. When patient is capable of taking oral antibiotics, I think the time-tested drug is amoxicillin. And we all know the regimen that an hour before the dental procedure, the patient takes 3 grams or 6 capsules of 500 milligrams of amoxicillin. And after 6 hours, because these concentration MIC will be remaining in the blood for about 6 hours. Therefore, at the end of 6 hours, many cardiologists suggest, many guidelines suggest that 1.5 grams, that is 3 capsules, should be repeated after 6 hours of amoxicillin. Those patients who cannot take orally because of anesthesia or something, then injectable ampicillin can be given. There are other drugs like linezolid or even azithromycin. Some countries suggest ciprofloxacin or other fluoroquinolones also, but we commonly use amoxicillin or ampicillin for infective endocarditis prophylaxis. And those patients who are at who have an allergy to penicillins, we suggest linezolid or azithromycin. So these are the important issues. I think I briefly covered most of the common topics that are important for the dentist from the cardiac point of view. For us, when we see a patient who is undergoing a cardiac procedure, like for example a valve replacement, we want that the oral hygiene of the patient should be good for two reasons. One, poor oral hygiene, as you know, leads to infections, and patients with artificial valves can develop infective endocarditis. So therefore, a good dental consultation with a proper counseling of adequate oral hygiene and whatever problems are there in the teeth should be taken care before. For one reason, that after the cardiac surgery, dental extraction becomes difficult. because of all this anticoagulation issue and issue of infective endocarditis. So if any teeth have to be extracted, it is often removed. Though there is some research which says that it may not be helpful at all, but still I think this is a common practice we are going through, that poor bad teeth, very carious teeth are removed before this. But in addition, these other important problems for patients who are going to have valve replacement surgery are periodontitis and apical infection, because these are also equally responsible for infective endocarditis in these patients. Therefore, a good dental consultation is what we require from yourselves, and it's always for the patient in the long run, it really is good. So I briefly touched upon certain aspects of patients visiting dentists with cardiac issues like hypertension, ischemic heart disease, underlying heart valves, various drugs like antihypertensives or antiplatelet drugs, anticoagulants. And also when we need your help, for patients who require to undergo cardiac surgery and they need to be cleared by the dentist for whatever preoperative correction or preoperative preparation of the oral cavity is required. So I will stop here, because I know that the one-sided lectures really don't work. I'm sure there are questions which you might want to ask me, and if I'm able to answer at this point of time, I can do it if time permits. So I think I'll stop here, and I throw open this for questions for some 10 minutes or so.
Thank you very much, sir. Am I audible?
Yes, Dr. Revan, you are.
Yeah. Thank you very, very much, sir. And I would like to convey the most important message to Dr. Venkatesh today from all of us would be...
So there is a question that Dr. Kundu is asking: if the patient is amoxicillin resistant, which antibiotic can be given? So we give commonly linezolid. Linezolid is very good for the organisms concerned. But one of the problems with linezolid is that sometimes it can give rise to... in rare cases, it can give rise to some complications. Therefore, commonly we use the azithromycin or clarithromycin. These drugs are used for patients who are amoxicillin resistant. Dr. Raven, you can see if there are any other questions.
Yeah. As what I have heard today. Thank you very much for being so precisely answering all our confusions that actually exist in our day-to-day practice. And the most controversial one for all of us is use of adrenaline and in hypertensive patients, and what level of blood pressure should be considered as risky, probably. What range of blood pressure should be considered as risky?
Okay. The level of blood pressure that should be considered as safe. So I guess normally up to 160 there should be no problem at all. One should be able to go ahead and perform the dental procedure. Sometimes while doing the procedure, patient can go up to 180. These are all not hard and fast rules, but I think many of our procedures when we are doing the patient's blood pressures do go up to 180 systolic. On the diastolic side, 90 is usually what we say is the upper limit for well-controlled blood pressure, but if it goes up to 100, I think one should not worry. So 160 to 180 on the chair, before starting the procedure up to 160, I think you can go ahead and do the procedure. The diastolic blood pressure corresponding is up to 100, you can go ahead and start the procedure. And after the procedure, the blood pressure should come down, especially if there is adequate pain relief. Because sometimes, please understand that dental pain itself can give rise to a slight elevation of blood pressure. On the other hand, any blood pressure which is way higher than that, that is more than 180 or 200, and the diastolic blood pressure is more than 100, I think if the patient is on your chair and if you have not started the procedure, maybe worthwhile rescheduling the procedure and then asking a physician to look at it and get the blood pressure controlled. Well, this question is from Dr. Kripa Shankar. No, sorry. This is from Dr. Rishabh Gupta, I suppose. Oh, no, Dr. Kripa Shankar posted this. Okay, now, I think how do we set up, how do we deal with cardiac emergencies which they happen in the outside the hospital setting? I think as all responsible citizens, one thing, while we are in the medical profession, I think the first thing we all should be aware of is cardiopulmonary resuscitation. It's not just that somebody is going to have an arrest in the dental clinic. It's not just that. Even outside in the community, when we see somebody with a who has a cardiac arrest, we should all be aware of basic CPR that, of course, will come in handy inside our own clinics. The other thing is to recognize cardiac symptoms. To recognize emergencies is a very important thing. Our clinics may not be well equipped, but we must have some basic things like saturation monitor. We should have a blood pressure apparatus and a stethoscope. So at least we should be able to take the pulse and blood pressure and saturation to see if a patient is having any complication. And if at all there is, we should always know how do we get this patient to the nearest hospital which has got cardiac facility. So it is difficult for us to keep a crash cart. We do advise that in any medical facility, there should be a crash cart with a defibrillator and adrenaline. But then if we have no experience in dealing with this, and if these kind of emergency equipment is going to add to the cost of this whole thing, and it is not mandated that these have to be kept in a dental clinic. So therefore, I think to recognize if there is any cardiac symptom, to recognize if there is any cardiac complication by looking at vital parameters, history, saturation, BP, pulse, and then summoning an ambulance to send to a nearest place. So that would be the first aid, which I think can be done in any dental clinic.
Dr. Pawan will be logging in a short while. They are attempting to reconnect to our network. Please wait. My sincere apologies for the network issue. I think the one is online now. Can you hear us, sir?
Yeah, I can hear you.
Okay, sir. Let me thank Dr. Venkatesh, sir, for his wonderful lecture and a wonderfully tailored lecture, I should say, because we were left with no questions to ask, because he had touched upon the most controversial and most important aspects what we are worried about in dentistry. Thank you very much, sir, for enlightening us with all the knowledge that you have got. Thank you, sir. Now we now move on to our next lecture, which becomes even more important in the background of this pandemic. Now we are all looking at pneumonia type of cases. We are all worried about COVID, and what better time to have Dr. Pawan with us. I will give a brief introduction to Dr. Pawan. Dr. Pawan is a consultant pulmonologist at Aster RV Hospital. He has over 9 years of experience in this field. He is he usually treats pulmonary diseases and takes care of critical care. He is an expert in sleep medicine and interventional pulmonology and lung transplantation. He completed his MBBS from JSS Medical College, Mysore, and then moved on to do his MD in respiratory diseases from Institute of Medical Sciences, Banaras Hindu University, Varanasi. Prior to joining Aster RV Hospital, he was associated with Gleneagles Global Health City as a consultant transplant pulmonologist at the Institute of Heart and Lung Transplantation. Other than what I have already mentioned, his areas of expertise include tracheobronchial stenting transplantation, fluoroscopy, rigid and semi-rigid, ECMO initiation and management, cryobiopsy and APC. Sir, we welcome you, sir. Over to you.
Thank you for the kind introduction. I just would like to know whether my PPT slides are visible.
Yes, sir. We can see you.
Okay, thank you so much. I would like to take this opportunity for the organizers for having us here and given this opportunity to talk about the most relevant topic for today, as has been spoken in the past regarding the ongoing pandemic of COVID. It has caused a havoc and a major concerns, especially in the field of medicine, and the most vulnerable population amongst these would be the people who are handling the airway issues, certainly pulmonologists, critical care people, and of course ENT and people who manage dental. I'd like to just brush off with the basics of pulmonology as well. Must have been many years of going through the basic texts of physiology and anatomy. This is how a respiratory system would look. And the breathing apparatus starts from the tip of the nose, air sacs called as alveoli. So the basic function of the respiratory system is to do an inhalation of the atmospheric air, extract the oxygen out of that air, and provide the cells in the body with the oxygen which is required for the basis. It could be sinusitis, rhinitis, and as you go along, there could be infection in the tonsillitis, adenoid infection, pharyngitis, laryngitis, tracheitis, bronchitis, and all the way there could be infection in the lungs. So any of these for people in the dentistry field, because there could be associated issues associated with the dental complications. So this is the introduction of that. As I mentioned, this is a basis of how it may hamper the breathing apparatus and may compromise the breathing apparatus and lead to drop in the oxygen levels and elevation in the carbon dioxide levels in the body, or may even suppress the ventilatory apparatus. So these are the problems which can arise while handling the dental procedures along with the sedation. So if you know exactly what the condition of the respiratory system in a given patient, you can actually foresee the complications and adjust your medications, timings of the procedure, or expect any complications which can arise from the procedure and be prepared to manage them or handle them in a better way. Okay. So basically you need to ask for any symptoms of respiratory infections or respiratory involvement, like cough, breathlessness, any sputum production or hemoptysis, wheezing, chest pain. Okay, so these are the usual symptoms that would happen, that would occur with a patient having a respiratory problems. And if there are any of these symptoms, then you need to think about what could be the possible reasons. And if you want, at this point in time, you can just take a chest x-ray or ask a physician opinion just to make sure there is no major lung issues or respiratory tract issues. So if we should also understand, in any emergency, we always go from A, B, C. A is airway management, B is breathing, C is cardiac as well as the cerebral perfusion, right? So the most important thing in any emergency is to make sure the airway is patent and the breathing is happening properly. So you need to make sure that if the basics are okay, then probably you should not get into any major problems or concerns when you're managing the dental issues. And once you know about the symptoms, and if the patient doesn't have any active symptoms, you should look into any signs basically. For example, even though the patient doesn't have any active symptoms, they may be having underlying chronic issues, like, for example, COPD, interstitial lung disease, bronchiectasis, etc., wherein the patient may not be, may not think that it is significant to be informed to you, or they may sometimes hide the history or may not be very forthcoming. So these signs, like clubbing in the hand, or maybe, oxygen levels being low, or elevated JVP, or cyanosis in the eyes, the heart rate fluctuations, and when you auscultate, some people may have actually abnormal respiratory sounds like wheezing, crackles, etc. So in case if it is grossly visible and obvious, then obviously you should go into the greater depth to understand if there are any underlying hidden respiratory issues which needs to be addressed before taking up the patient for any dental procedures or dental issues. Now, with the COVID being in the forefront in the last few months, so you should also ask for any features of active infection or any previous exposure to COVID as well. Some people who have recovered from severe form of COVID disease may have some amount of underlying lung issues like post-COVID fibrosis, etc., and for which the patient might have been on oxygen or might have been put on certain medications which may interfere with your treatment. So these are the common respiratory infections. Like upper respiratory, we can have rhinitis, sinusitis, pharyngitis, etc. And the lower down, there can be infection of the bronchi, acute bronchitis, pneumonia, bronchiolitis, asthma, COPD, and these are all a few of the common respiratory problems that may be associated in your patients. Okay. So sinus-wise, there are different sinuses like ethmoid sinus, frontal, maxillary, and sphenoid sinuses. So different sinus involvement will cause different types of symptoms. I think you people will be well aware of these. And if there are associated symptoms, and especially in the COVID era, you should make sure that the person is not having an active infection, and also should make sure they're not active, they're not infectious to the hospital staff, treating doctors, etc. And if required, it's always a wise idea to get them tested with a COVID swab. And if it is negative, to treat the active infection with antivirals or antibiotics, whatever is required, and then take them up for the procedure required if it is not an emergency, right? Okay. So next most common respiratory problem that you may come across will be bronchial asthma. So what happens in bronchial asthma is that the breathing tubes, right? We discussed about this, the bronchi and the bronchioles, normally are supposed to be patent this way. And in patients who have bronchial asthma, the airway wall, the muscle becomes thicker, and they also undergo spasm and constriction. The inner mucosal lining undergoes a swelling, and this eventually leads to the significant reduction in the cross-sectional diameter of the airway. So basically, the amount of air going in and out of the lungs into the alveoli is significantly reduced in patient with bronchial asthma. Right, is significantly less. And if you suppress his respiration here, he will definitely develop hypoxia or CO2 retention. He may become drowsy and go into respiratory failure. So patient with bronchial asthma, it all depends upon how severe the disease is, whether it's early bronchial asthma, the mild form of disease, with a severe form of disease, whether the patient has been on inhaler, one inhaler, two inhalers, or have they been on, some people with severe form of disease may be on a long-term small dose of steroids. And in these group of patients, you may have to increase the dose of steroids temporarily for the time of doing a major procedure. And before the procedure, we also advise to give a shot of the inhaler or maybe an nebulization if required, just to make sure that the airway stays open. Okay. And in asthma as well, there are different types of asthma, like allergic asthma, non-allergic, exercise-induced asthma, drug-induced asthma, as well as infectious. So some people who have this allergic asthma are more sensitive to certain drugs, and they may develop severe and significant form of allergic reactions. So you should always ask a detailed history whether what all they're allergic to, specifically the medications. It may be a local anesthetic, it may be antibiotic, it may be a painkiller, etc. It's always a wise idea to take a detailed history just to make sure they're not allergic to any of the medication which you intend to use in your patient, right? And infection, if there are any features of acute infection, it's better to treat them and then take them for the planned procedure. So the next common respiratory disease is COPD, is chronic obstructive pulmonary disease, quite often seen in males who are smokers. Strong association with the smoking is seen, and it can present as either chronic bronchitis or emphysema. Clinically, we don't usually see, you know, either one of these. Most of them are going to be overlap features would be there. And clinically, we call them as either blue bloaters with chronic bronchitis or pink puffers with emphysema. Okay, so here as well, you should make sure that the person's medications are checked properly, and you should make sure that the inhaler medications are continued through the therapy. And if they're getting admitted, just to make sure that the nebulizations are continued and should not be stopped. And also go through the details of any steroid medication required. Some people with severe form of COPDs may be using oxygen at home or maybe on BiPAP support. And some these people will be very, very sensitive to any type of sedatives which you may intend to use. Sometimes even patients who are started on anti-allergies like Avil or sedative allergic agent with sedative properties may also actually push these patients into respiratory failure. So in severe form of COPDs, so you just have to be cautious with these group of patients. And some of these patients may also have an associated right heart failure with pulmonary edema, and they may be cyanosed, hypoxic, etc. So some people may also come to you with, you know, borderline lung function, and you may take little time to optimize them. And it's always a good idea to wait until that optimization has happened, and keep yourself well prepared. And also, if they are on BiPAP support. And some of these patients may have associated obstructive sleep apnea as well. We call it as overlap syndrome. So obstructive sleep apnea is a condition wherein their upper airways have extensive amount of collapsibility with very narrow passages, which can easily collapse. With features of COPD. So these are the patients whom you have to watch out for and be extremely cautious and in dealing with these patients, especially with the while doing procedures and you intend to give any sedation. And the most common problem with this patient with COPD is smoking, and associated, and you should always take a detailed history about smoking in these patients, because smoking also can have oral manifestation of its own, like melanosis, nicotine stomatitis, dysplastic changes in oral mucosa. And you need to look out for these if there are any signs of these features in chronic smokers, especially if they have any features of COPD. Okay. So the next common clinical condition is something called as bronchiectasis. And in the West, we get a lot of patients with cystic fibrosis, which is just lungs. Okay. These patients have a very thick secretions which gets pulled up in the sinuses and in the airways and can get repeatedly infected. And most often they come colonized with lot of multi-drug resistant organisms, most commonly being Pseudomonas. So when you're treating these patients, you should expect that their airways to be contaminated or colonized, and you should give them adequate antibiotic cover post procedure, because okay, there's a most, and also these patients tend to be a little hypoxic, and they can easily slip into respiratory failures, and you need to keep that in mind as well. The next most common condition that we see in India, of course, is tuberculosis. It can have its own oral manifestations in the form of oral ulcers, especially in the dorsum or the lateral margins of the tongue and labia mucosa. And if you know that patient has history of tuberculosis in the lungs or anywhere else in the body, and if you're examining the oral cavity, you should look for any signs of any tubercular manifestation there. And you should also make sure that the patient has been on anti-tubercular medications for a certain period of time, just to make sure that he's not infective anymore to the doctors and the hospital staff. And unless it's an emergency, you should always make sure that patient has taken an adequate amount of ABT and is non-infective before going for taking up for any procedures. And certain group of medications which are given to treat tubercular infection, like isoniazid, rifampicin, pyrazinamide, and ethambutol. These are the most common medications that we use. And out of these, rifampicin tend to increase the metabolization of many of the drugs. And also, it can rifampicin can have significant hepatotoxicity, and should be careful while giving patient medications which are metabolized through the liver in this group of patients. And also, some people may be on injectable medications to treat tuberculosis, like streptomycin or amikacin injections, and this can have nephrotoxicity or ototoxicity. And you should make sure that the medication which you want to use should not interact with this group of medication which the patient has already been taking. Okay. So the next common condition is called as sarcoidosis, which is a great mimicker. It can present with lymphadenopathy, mediastinal lymphadenopathy, and it can involve multiple organs in the body, from lungs to eyes to liver, kidneys, even skin, brain, etc. Most of these patients with sarcoidosis will be on long-term steroids probably, and we should be aware that these people may, because they're on chronic steroids, they may have poor healing and lower resistance, and they may be a little high on the sugars as well, because and it may be difficult to treat infections, and wound healing may be a problem in these patients who are on chronic steroids. For that matter, most of the respiratory patient, when they come in acute exacerbation, are put on steroids, and steroids, as we all know, will push the sugar levels a little high, and may interfere with the healing process, and we should be well informed when you take patients, such patients, for any procedures, right? Okay. So in general, what would be the guidelines for oral healthcare for patient with respiratory disease? So most of the patients, the procedures we recommend to be done in the morning hours, whenever there is an airway involvement, whenever there is a complicated procedure involving patient with multiple comorbidities, especially airway complications. We recommend to take up these patients when most of the hospital staffs, ICU, and emergency care is fully totally available, and should be taken up first thing in the morning or maybe in the morning hours. And that's the first thing. Second is medication which can cause respiratory suppression, right? Which suppress the ventilatory apparatus of the respiratory system, should be avoided. That may be anxiolytic drugs, that may be sedative drugs or anti-allergic drugs. Any form of drug which would suppress the breathing of the patient should be avoided. And you should take a detailed history of any allergies such patients may be having, especially patients who have allergic rhinitis, who have bronchial asthma, any form of other eczemas, etc. You should know the detailed history of any allergies which they come with. And the COPD patients, long-term lung involvement, will have right heart failures or right heart dilatation. We call them as corpulmonale, and they'll be very sensitive to develop any arrhythmias, and you should be careful in giving adrenaline. Adrenaline usually given along with local anesthetics. If the dose is high, they may be a little sensitive to develop this cardiac rhythm abnormalities. And they recommend to avoid bilateral mandibular blocks. And aspirins or even NSAIDs, some asthmatics may be aspirin sensitive, like aspirin-induced asthma. So should be careful not to use aspirin or any NSAIDs. For example, diclofenac or even brufen can induce an asthma attack in these patients. And so the most safest, of course, is paracetamol. And But if the patient is a tubercular patient and paracetamol, since it is metabolized through the liver, we should consider the possibility of hepatotoxicity if you're giving very high dose. And when you're treating a patient with bronchial asthma, you should also keep the nebulizers or maybe steroid injections handy, so that an oxygen handy. So in case if they go into a asthmatic attack or start having any wheezing issues, you can at least give them a nebulization and do the initial treatment required. Okay. And so whenever there's oral infection is involved, we always recommend to identify the specific form of infection so that an appropriate antibiotics can be used. And especially if the patients have other lung involvements like bronchiectasis or tuberculosis, etc. And if you see an associated infection in the oral cavity, instead of presuming it to be the same infection, we'd always try to identify whether it is a secondary infection or some other infection which may be associated or present in the oral cavity. Okay. And antibiotics wise, the physician have to take a call as to which is safe and which is most effective for the given patient, and also should be allergic profile should also be considered. And some people prefer to use theophylline in patient with COPD, and certain medications like erythromycin, ciprofloxacin and clindamycin may cause theophylline toxicity by displacing theophylline from the plasma binding protein, so that should be taken care of. And respiratory patients on long-term antibiotics need adjustment to antibiotic treatment for oral infections or prophylaxis. And I think Dr. Venkatesh must have gone through the prophylaxis which is required in cardiac patients. And so we should also, for respiratory patients also, we should understand if the patient has been on any chronic antibiotics. Where would we use chronic antibiotics? In patients with colonization of the airways, like patient with bronchiectasis, systemic bronchiectasis, we may give azithromycin on alternate days or every day for a long time to take care of this colonization. So you should be aware of the antibiotics. And these macrolides like azithromycin can cause a little bit of QT prolongation issues. So you should be aware of those issues. And they say rubber dam is ill-advised in patients with dyspnea. If patient have obvious lung issues, you should avoid using rubber dam. And have the patient use their inhalers prophylactically before taking up any patient with bronchial asthma. Make sure you continue the medications, especially the respiratory medication. If the patient has been on oxygen, continue using oxygen. Patient has been on inhalers or nebulizers, please continue the medications and get them as optimal as optimized before the procedure as possible. And certain sedative agents like barbiturates can cause laryngeal spasm and respiratory attack of asthma. And benzodiazepine, as I discussed, or narcotics and barbiturates should be avoided because they can cause respiratory suppression. And patients with long-standing COPD with elevated carbon dioxide levels will be dependent upon the CO2 drives, which drives the respiration. So we should not target to give very high oxygen in these patients, and their acceptable SpO2 levels may be anywhere between 92% to 94%. So that needs to be understood. And giving a very high flow oxygen can lead to CO2 retention, and they may become drowsy and go into respiratory failure. Okay. And continuous monitoring of blood pressure and pulse, during the treatment also is absolutely required. And with the patients having respiratory issues, we recommend to monitor their oxygen levels as well, just to make sure that they're not getting hypoxic and going into respiratory failure. Okay. So I would stop there, and I would like to take any specific questions if there are any. And so this is a brief of the things, how I would take prophylaxis or may take precautions to not push patients with respiratory problems into failure. And if you have any questions or any points to add or any suggestions, I think I'll be open for it. And thank you all for your attention.
Thank you very much, sir. It was indeed a wonderful, crisp presentation of the plethora of diseases that the respiratory system is exposed to. Quickly, I would like to ask you two clarifications, sir. One is regarding tuberculosis. Tuberculosis still dominates our Indian scenario all over the country, despite having the best of the best medicines. The compliance is the biggest issue. And to ascertain the infective status of the patient with tuberculosis, what could be the steps we should follow?
Okay. So, if the patient has been a case of pulmonary tuberculosis, and if they have a cavitary lung disease, which you call it as an open case of tuberculosis. So every time the patient coughs, he may bring up sputum, which is infective, right? So we would recommend to do a chest X-ray and see since how long the patient has been taking the antituberculosis treatment and to see whether the patient has responded to the treatment or not. So clinically, we assess it by doing a chest X-ray and repeating the sputum samples to look for acid-fast bacilli. If it was positive initially, it should become come negative later in time, and also you should look at the duration of the treatment. They usually within if they respond well, if it is a drug sensitive tuberculosis which responds well to the first line of treatment within 2 to 3 weeks, they should become mostly non-infective. But it may be a good idea to wait for 3 to 4 weeks. Before considering this patient for any treatment. I think any pulmonologist should be able to that needs a deep cleaning and proper sterilization so that it doesn't cause cross-contamination, cross-infection in other patients, and also the hospital staff should not be in the risk of contracting infections from them. Thank you.
Sir, any gold standard test for tuberculosis which you would recommend when in suspicious cases, like we used to do Van't Hoff's reaction test. Is it still the right thing?
Sorry, sir, I lost you. What reaction?
Van't Hoff's test.
No, okay. No, sir. It is a the Man2 and this Quantiferon TB Gold, okay. They will tell you these are the tests for latent tuberculosis. They just say that the patient has been exposed to tuberculosis at certain point in time. That doesn't say that the patient is having active disease right now. So see whether the patient has active disease. First, you should look at the symptoms, whether the patient has any symptoms of fever, weight loss, loss of appetite, or any organ-specific symptoms. Like, for example, lung, they may have expectorations, sputum production, hemoptysis, etc. If they have a kidney involvement, they have different symptoms like that. And you should take sample from that particular organ. For example, if the lungs are involved, we would send the sputum for AFB. And the sensitive and specific test which is freely available is the GeneXpert MTB. Okay, the GeneXpert is it's a nested RT-PCR. It's a PCR test, nested PCR, which gives reports within 2 hours. You can identify the Mycobacterium tuberculosis in the given sample, and also it says whether the given organism is sensitive to the first line of medications like rifampicin. It is called as GeneXpert MTB RIF. It will tell you whether the given organism is resistant to rifampicin or not for the first line of medication. So that will also tell you whether the infection is MDR or it's a simple type of tuberculosis. So I would recommend to use GeneXpert in these samples, which will give the reports much earlier, and also it's quite sensitive and specific, and in government facilities is conducted free of cost as well.
Sir, in our experience of whatever last 15 years I have been practicing oral medicine, I have come across two cases where it was very confusing quite early in my career that they could have been tuberculous ulcers in the oral cavity. And those days I think we didn't have this test. So this is a good test for us to follow up, sir. We would like to thank Dr. Pawan Yadav, who did a wonderful presentation and took us through the various diseases that respiratory system gets affected with. We couldn't ask him questions live. I'm very sure you can post them here. I will see to it that we will personally meet him and ask those questions and put it across to you guys when send it to you through an email or WhatsApp or whichever way we can. We'll definitely do that. So I now move on to the next speaker of our line, another eminent doctor who deals with a lot of infections and antimicrobials, Dr. Sukrut Chandappa. He is MBBS and MD in pharmacology. He did his MBBS in Mysore Medical College, and he has completed MD in pharmacology at Bangalore Medical College. He has worked in various hospitals and occupational health clinics across Karnataka, and is currently working as medical advisor at GSK under GSK Pharmaceuticals under anti-infective portfolio. He has also worked in a contract research organization and was supporting to conduct the bioavailability and bioequivalent studies. He has conducted various research and published a lot of articles in the field of diabetes, drug-related challenges faced by elderly population, drafted a review article called Practice Guidance in Management of Odontogenic Infection. Yeah, he is supporting to prepare and conduct many clinical trials in the anti-infective space. He is actively participating in creating awareness among healthcare providers on antimicrobial resistance across India. We are glad to have him here. I think he has some network issues. He will be joining us in a couple of minutes. Kindly wait. And let me also inform our viewers that Karnataka State Dental Council has approved two CDE credit points for this program. At the end of this program, we will collect the list of people who attended it, and each one of you will get an email. I hope you have logged in through the right email. If you haven't, please log out and log in through the right email, and then you will all get a questionnaire or a feedback form where you have to fill in your name in the right spelling, as well as your phone number, your Karnataka State Dental Council registration number, or whichever state dental council registration number you have. Please put in the appropriate column, and then send it back to us so that we can prepare the certificates and send it to you. I think we are glad to have our president of IDA Karnataka State Branch, Dr. Sudhindra Kumar. Sir, can you please speak a few words to our audience, sir?
Thank you, Raymond. Thank you. Can you hear me? I'm audible.
Yes, sir. We can hear you, and we are very glad you can finally meet. Dr. Sudhindra was very busy with his meeting. He took time out of it, and he is addressing us. Over to you, sir. Please go ahead.
Good afternoon, everybody. I think we have. I was a bit late. I had some connecting issues. Thank you, Raymond, for arranging this webinar from the Bangalore branch. I thank Dr. Venkatesh, Dr. Yadav, Dr. Girish, and others for giving a good presentation. I think, Raven, we have arranged this webinar on a Saturday at 2 o'clock. People would have worked very hard and come for a siesta. I think we have spoiled their siesta. Can you, am I audible, Raven?
Yes, sir, you are audible, sir.
So, apologies for that. We'll have to have a lot of webinars like this in future also. Thank you, one and all.
Thank you very much, sir. Your inspiration and motivation is what brings us all to this level, and we will always try and work hard towards achieving more knowledge and have a wonderful practice in future. Thank you very much for your kind words, sir. We are still waiting for Dr. Sukrut to come online. His network seems to have some problem. We will play some video in between before we get in Dr. Sukrut here.
living in the moment, and here we are dreaming in the open. Now look around, isn't this a new day? Make a move, doing things a new way. This is our world, and this is our time. These are our plans, we're gonna let them shine.
I'm Dr. Jayachandran, Professor Head, Department of Oral Medicine Radiology, Kannur Government Dental Hospital. This gives me a proud moment and being in dental professions. It provides an opportunity to serve for the people who suffer from oral dental diseases. And also, it's given me a good opportunity to bridging the medical profession or dental professionals. Oral health is an integral part of dental health. And it is an opportunity to serve as well as create awareness to oral and health problem to the society. Thank you very much.
As oral diagnosticians, through early diagnosis and intervention, help save lives and improving the quality of life of patients. We are honored to be in this field of work, which gives purpose to our lives.
Happy Dental Day. Thank you.
Hello everyone. I am Dr. Ashwin Zavadekar. I am very fortunate, happy and proud to be a student, teacher and a practitioner of pediatric and preventive dentistry. My profession gives me an immense opportunity to help children eat well, breathe well, sleep well, grow well, play sports safely, and have an overall good quality of life.
Hello everyone, I am Dr. Hani Gurbakshani Kalyani from Nagpur, Maharashtra. I am a practicing orthodontist here. If you begin to ask me why am I proud of my profession, why am I proud of dentistry, it's because I bring about correction of the smiles. I give happy faces to a lot many people. Also, there's a slight change which dentistry has brought in my life. Instead of focusing on people's eyes, the way they talk, the way they do their hair, the way they dress up, I only focus on their teeth. So my only focus when I meet somebody new is on their malalignment and the malocclusion. So that's what dentistry has done to me.
Good morning, friends. I'm Dr. MGS Prasad. Happy Dentist Day to all of you. Dentistry is my prime profession wherein I do everything. Whatever success I am today, I really owe it to the dentistry. Dentistry has given me bread, butter, and also cream. So you know what dentistry has given. So we are one of the white-collar professions where we deal with patients in all aspects. Physically, emotionally, psychologically, we treat the patient. Happy Dentist Day.
There is a connectivity issue on the last speaker's side. We are trying to get it rectified. Please hold on. In the meanwhile, I have got a couple of questions. One of my dear colleague, Dr. Kripa Shankar, a professor in Coorg Institute of Dental Sciences, has asked how to identify asymptomatic carriers of COVID-19 infection. I have forwarded it to Dr. Pavan Yadav, and as soon as we get the reply from him, I will pass it on to Dr. Kripa Shankar personally. And in the meanwhile, I was actually thinking of looking up for something. I mean, I have somewhere around 80 attendees here. We would like, as a part of being a convener for IDA in Bangalore branch, And with this pandemic around, we have been hosting a lot of webinars. I would like to know which would be the topic that you guys would be interested in. Please do text the topics that you would be interested in, and we would get the best in our field to actually speak about it so that all of us get benefited by it. It is a two-way benefit always. As an CD convener, it is my duty to give you the best possible, and it's also your responsibility to convey your needs to me so that I can take it further from here. And I will see to it that we organize regularly webinars at a time that is very convenient to us. We chose Saturday because, yeah, this is like an afternoon and we can definitely spend some time and go back and hit to our practices. Weekend is the best day to practice, and then we can have some good rest tomorrow. So please feel free, and I'm putting down my email ID here on the comment section. You can email me the topics of your interest so that we can arrange for good, interesting webinars in future. And we, as a part of IDEA Bangalore branch, are also looking forward to organize those basic life support courses. I am already in talk with a couple of hospitals in South and North Bangalore so that we can organize it in places which will be nearer to you. Of course, if you need a certificate, you will have to pay for it. But it is something worth doing every 6 months, getting a practice directly onto on the mannequins and refreshing our skills on basic life support is something that is mandatory, must be mandatory for all of us. And because of these disruptions, I know many of you will be leaving and joining. I will make sure that the recording link is sent to you, and the recorded link will be available on YouTube for probably YouTube or Facebook portal for about 15 to 20 days so that you can go back and see for sure. I still expect you to be around with us so that we can hear Dr. Shukrut, who's going to speak about a very important topic about dental infections and how to choose which antibiotic is what we are going, what he's going to talk about, oral infections and the choice of antibiotics. So I request you all to hold on, bear with us. It's all about connectivity. India doesn't have power supply so regular. So I think there is a power failure on the other side, and they are rectifying it, and we should be back in few minutes now. And since Dr. Kripashankar brought about COVID active infectious disease, I would like to reflect upon a few thoughts that I have learned over a couple of months of treating people in Bangalore and also interacting with a lot of pulmonologists and people who are treating actual COVID patients. See, these guys who have been treated or hospitalized and treated for COVID, especially the ones with comorbidities, are generally put on blood thinners to prevent any clots. And they are also on a high dose of steroids. And what happens with this is we saw a case of 38-year-old boy ending up with severe osteomyelitis spreading all over to the ramus as well as onto the body of the mandible on one side. Our surgeon did a wonderful job. He removed the cortical plate and curettaged that area and allowed it to heal. But yes, this is one of the common manifestations that we are seeing in oral cavity. Other than petechiae, ecchymosis, and the patients who have bruxism, who have suffered with COVID and got admitted, were on blood thinners, tend to develop those red lines along the frictional keratosis area or a linea alba, which is seen on the inner aspect of the buccal mucosa. So these are pretty common. So if you have a patient who has been treated for COVID in a hospital setup, please see through his history very nicely and see what medications he was on. And the ones who are already on steroids or who are continuing to have steroids, and you have to treat this patient for some dental emergency. It could be an abscess, it could be a cellulitis case or stuff like that. Please always seek an opinion from his physician, treating physician, or a pulmonologist before you actually try attempting any treatment, because this patient can be really bad, or the infection there may not improve, if not worsen, despite your best efforts that you have put to do an extraction or incision and drainage. So yeah, we can see your screen now. So,
Okay, okay. Thank you. Is my slides visible?
Yeah.
So I welcome again. Happy to be here to meet all of you, and I wish all of you a happy National Dentist Day. So we're going to see about this. The session is on the dental management and disease management of the dental infections. So this slide, as this slide shows, we have two beautiful people carrying their beautiful smile at all of us, and there is a saying that smile is the best ornament a person can wear, and that is very true and evident from this picture. And oral health is, it's been regarded rightfully as very important, even in the scriptures and all over, the times. So let us see about, the disease management of the dental infections in today's session. So myself, I am Dr. Shanmugarajan Dayanidhi. I've completed my MEBS, and I'm MD in pharmacology from Jipma Puducherry. And I'm currently a full-time GSK employee as a medical advisor and of the anti-infective team. So with that introduction, let's go into the session. So the overall session, first we're going to see a bit of introduction, the diagnosis and the predisposing factor, the challenges associated with dental infections, the etiological organisms, and the prescribing, again, the challenges in the prescribing. Then we're going to see about amoxicillin, clavulanate. We're first going to see its characteristics, and we're also going to see about how it's a very good potential choice for dental infection, and some of the clinical trial evidences for amoxicillin clavulanate. So coming on to the introduction, so not only the scriptures, even WHO, rightfully regarded oral health is one of the key indicator, as a key indicator of overall health, well-being, as well as the quality of life. And if we see the epidemiology, that severe periodontitis is the sixth most prevalent disease, and the lifetime prevalence of dental abscesses has been reported as 5 to 46%. And one of the main important thing with odontogenic infections is because this has a lot of impact on the social life as well as the work productivity. Because it has a direct impact on all of these factors because of the pain and the discomfort that is associated. So coming on to the predisposing factors. So the predisposing factors can be classified into cariogenic factors, periodontal disease factors, and general factors. For example, poor oral hygiene and even diet, and smoking, diabetes, mellitus, and if we see the general factors, general immunosuppression or cancer chemotherapy, alcohol abuse, and others. So coming on to the dental infections, we have the pulpitis or periapical abscess, we have periodontitis, pericoronitis, then gingival abscess, as well as the deep facial space infections and various predisposing conditions to these infections as well. So most of the dental infections or abscesses for that matter do not need antibiotics or require minimal procedures alone. But if there are potential complications and which can occur and which include, for example, it can lead to systemic features like fevers or chills or involvement of the masseter muscle and causing trismus or lockjaw. Or it can cause airway impairment due to uvular deviation or elevation of floor of mouth. And it can, by contiguous spread, it can cause some complications. For example, Ludwig's angina or maxillary sinusitis. Or it can spread superficially, resulting in dentocutaneous fistulae. And one of the rare condition which could turn to be fatal also is a cavernous sinus thrombosis. So let's see about the etiology of the odontogenic infections. So typically the odontogenic infections, the bacteriological population or the bacteria are typically polymicrobial. So we have the gram-positive facultative anaerobes, gram-positive anaerobes, then gram-negative anaerobic bacteria. So this is one of the challenges with dental infections because of the infections are polymicrobial and typically broad-spectrum antibiotics are required. And if we see these three broad, the population of bacteria or the group of bacteria, the most notorious are the gram-negative anaerobes. But typically the Fusobacterium, Privotella, Bacterioids, these species, because they produce beta-lactamase, and the recent data is showing that these beta-lactamase producing organisms are encountered in a close to 50%. So this is again, we have seen the gram-negative anaerobes. They're a major class of bacteria, and they can account up to 80% of the isolates. And these four bacteria are typically notorious because they are beta-lactamase producing. Thus, they are resistant to the penicillin group of drugs by cleaving up the beta-lactam ring and rendering them ineffective. So these the concept of antimicrobial resistance does not need much of introduction, because I know we have been hearing a lot of news and impact of this antimicrobial resistance typically in the last 10-15 years, because this has been increasing. For example, with respect to the dental infections, the resistance rates, tetracyclines are showing resistance up to 40%, then variable levels with erythromycin, metronidazole. And if we see the penicillin group of drugs, they are relatively, they are slow in development of resistance. Next, let us see about the some of the challenges in prescribing dental practice. So one challenge what we have seen is, because the infection tends to be polymicrobial, we need to choose a broad spectrum antibiotic. And the next is the duration of antibiotics. So there is not a wide consensus regarding the universal or accepted duration of antibiotic, because one physiology is the disturbance, because the oral cavity is the exposed part of GIT, there is misbalance in the normal biofilm. So exaggerated antibiotic therapy itself can cause disturbance of this biofilm. So one challenge is the duration of antibiotic therapy is mainly based on expert opinion. So now let's see about the management of dental abscesses. What are the key considerations? So if we see the considerations or the management falls in line with the priorities of the patient. So the most important priority is the pain management, which usually a local procedure is sufficient, because much of the pain is due to the increased pressure in the the small compartment which is involved. So of course pain management, so local procedure or without with or without analgesics, we can go for systemic analgesics. In that case, we can go for paracetamol or ibuprofen or even a diclofenac. Local analgesics can be given, but they have a challenge of frequent application and taste alteration as well. Then the local procedure to drain the pus. Then next is to assess the risk. So this assessment of risk for local or systemic spread of infection determines whether it is complicated or uncomplicated. So usually for a localized abscess, antibiotics are not indicated, but definitely they have a role. For example, drainage is not possible. For example, abscess is not easily accessible, or the abscess, there is an emerging abscess and the patient is immunocompromised and general health is affected. So in that case, antibiotics definitely have a role. So with this in this line, let us discuss the guideline of the NICE guidelines from UK, National Institute of Health and Care Excellence guidelines for the management of dental abscess. So the first step in this algorithm or in this flow is determining whether the dental abscess is complicated or not. So that determines whether there is a risk for local or systemic spread. For example, there is some evidence of cellulitis, or there is systemic involvement, or there is risk of systemic involvement. So if those things are present, then it is it's a complicated or prone for complication abscess. So in that case, antibiotics and local procedure both are indicated. But if there is no such evidence, then local procedures and analgesics are adequate. So if failure occurs, then antibiotics can be given. So the first line as per this guidelines is amoxicillin, penicillin, and metronidazole. Clindamycin if there is penicillin allergy. If the treatment is ineffective, then second line drugs like amoxicillin, clavulanate, and others can be considered. So next, let us see about amoxicillin, clavulanate. How is it a potential choice for dental infections? So first let us see the attributes of an ideal agent. So we will see how an ideal agent should be, and we'll see how amoxicillin clavulanate fits into this. So the first most important criteria is the drug should be effective, because our goal is 100% eradication or near 100% eradication. And the next is appropriate PK profile, because the drug what we are giving, it should have achieve adequate concentration at the relevant site. For example, the crevicular fluid and nearby areas, because it is the unbound fraction of the drug which is going to exert the bacterial killing action. Next, a dosing schedule that facilitates compliance. This is very important, because already the patient is at distress from the symptoms, and the regimen what we are giving should be comfortable to his or her lifestyle, so that he is compliant to the entire regimen and completes the treatment. Next, the drug should have a favorable risk-benefit profile. So with this, let us discuss about amoxicillin clavulanate. So we all know that, we saw in the previous slide that the gram-negative anaerobes, they are producing the beta-lactamase enzyme. So this enzyme, what it does is it opens the beta-lactam ring and renders the antibiotic ineffective. So what is this clavulanate is? Basically, it's an enzyme inhibitor. It is a neutral molecule. It does not kill bacteria on its own. But what it does is it inactivates the enzyme that is produced by these organisms like Prevotella and others, so that the beta-lactam ring present in the amoxicillin is not opened and the amoxicillin can continue its bacterial killing. So that is the mechanism of action in short of amoxicillin clavulanate. So this is a source, it is produced from Streptomyces clavuligeris. It's an irreversible binding, rest of the clavulanic properties we had saw already. So coming on to the spectrum of action. So these are the spectrum of action of various drugs to these important bacteria. For example, Prevotella, Fusobacterium, and Streptococcus oralis. So if we see, amoxicillin is having intermediate to those three organisms, Prevotella, Porphyromonas, Fusobacterium, compared to, whereas amoxicillin clavulanate is having action against all of these, mainly because of the beta-lactamase production. This is a group wise action. Again, amoxicillin clavulanate is having, for example, 96% effectiveness, or the organisms are 96% susceptible, which belong to gram positive cocci, and 78% to gram negative bacilli, and 100% of gram positive bacilli. So this again, it's a PK or a pharmacokinetic evaluation of twice daily and thrice daily. So what this does is it compares twice daily administration of 625 milligram thrice daily administration of 625 milligram, which is represented by the lower figure, and the twice daily 1 gram administration, which is present in the upper figure. So both the regimens are adequately effective, because the concentration is maintained for up to 40% of the dosing interval. Because we know, for the penicillin group of drugs, what is important is the time duration for which the tissue concentration is maintained, and that is adequate between both the regimens. And with respect to tissue penetration also, amoxicillin clavulanate achieves good concentration in the gingival crevicular fluid. Next, if we see the safety, the most common adverse effect is, the diarrhea, which can be reduced by taking the drug at the start of a meal, because it optimizes the absorption. So the residual drug present in the gut is less, so there is less chances of diarrhea as well. And other minor side effects like nausea, vomiting, and other cautionary use include hypersensitivity, patients with hepatic impairment, and others. So thus, we have seen that amoxicillin clavulanate, its spectrum of action, its PK properties, and others, comparison between twice daily and thrice daily. So next, let's see about some of the clinical studies. So this study is a comparison of efficacy between amoxicillin clavulanate, 625 thrice daily, and azithromycin. So we can see that there is 96% success with amoxicillin clavulanate and 91% success with azithromycin with respect to the number of subjects that is cured at the end of the study. But if you see the p-value, it is non-significant. So which means both the groups are performing similar. But if we see, there is a 5% difference with azithromycin which is not significant, but few of these isolates were resistant because, you know, azithromycin or macrolide resistance has, you know, been increasing over the years compared to the penicillin. Next is another study which is called the Ogden study. So this again, it compares 1 milligram twice daily of amoxicillin clavulanate with clindamycin, which is given 4 times daily. So again, if we see the success, it is similar between both the groups because p value is not significant. But this, with respect to compared to clindamycin, and this may be important because the symptomatic relief is one of the priority of the patient. So to summarize, we saw about dental abscesses and management of dental abscesses as per NICE guidelines of UK. Then we saw about the amoxicillin clavulanic acid, its properties, what is the role of clavulanic acid, its spectrum of action. Then we saw about the PK properties of twice daily and thrice daily amoxicillin clavulanate. And lastly, we saw about some of the clinical studies with amoxicillin clavulanate. So thank you. Thank you very much. You've been a great audience. Thank you for your patience as well. Dr. Raven.
Yeah. Can you hear me now?
Yes, I can hear you, Dr. Yes.
Okay. Thank you, Dr. Shukra. Thank you, Dr. Rajan. It was wonderful hearing you. It was an impromptu lecture for you, but you still managed it wonderfully as always. One question that I would like, you have touched upon most of the questions that we usually have confusion about. Yeah. One question that I would like to ask you, it's not related pertaining to just amoxicillin. I was just trying to get the pulse of the pharmaceutical industries. What are they doing in, these antibiotics have always been havoc on the gastrointestinal system.
Yes.
Is there a way in which, is there a lead going in this direction wherein, okay, we can reduce the amount of microflora that it hits in the gut, or something in that direction, is it being done? Is there any in that direction? We all depend upon either probiotics during the antibiotic therapy as well as PPIs, proton pump inhibitors.
Yes.
So neither of them seem to work in many of our cases. Mm-hmm. The patient eventually ends up with a loose motion, and the question of stopping the antibiotic comes up there.
Yes,
so
yes.
What do you think should be the way in which we should be managing it? As well as if there is any research happening in this direction, please enlighten us all.
So mainly this antibiotic associated diarrhea, it is there is no wide consensus regarding to the mechanism of why it happens. For example, a few said like it is dose dependent, there are few evidences that it is not dose dependent. For example, if we see the high dose compared to a high dose amoxicillin and a normal dose amoxicillin, few studies, for example, let's say 60% of the studies, they are saying there is no difference.
We left actually.
We were actually looking at, there are no credible research which is going to tell us like, okay, this is the reason why antibiotic related diarrhea happens.
Okay, so that means we are at the end of the slide, I guess then.
No, we have finished the slides and you have taken.
Okay. Taken the questions. Okay.
We had taken the questions. In the question I had asked is basically about the post-antibiotic GI symptoms. How do we go about managing it? Is there any lead in the pharmaceutical industry which is trying to see alter the gut microflora and only attack the bacteria which we want to attack?
Okay. So basically, when we when we see an antibiotic induced diarrhea,
Dr. Raven, am I sorry? I got this.
So I think both of you are trying to log into the same thing. I just heard Dr. Shukrat talking.
Okay.
And then now we are. You can finish the answer so that we can end the program and then take it up.
Yes, Dr. Raven. Like as I mentioned, there is a consensus or there is not a consensus regarding to the dose dependency of this effect. So whether this effect is dependent on the dose or not, because there is complex, you know, with respect to the interaction. So mostly it happens. There is a reduced cyst absorption so that there is more drug that is left in the gastrointestinal tract that is acting on these microorganisms, creating a disbalance that is causing this effect. So that is why, for example, with respect to amoxicillin clavulanate, we tell them to take at the start of the meal so that there is optimized absorption. So there is more effectiveness. Also, there is less adverse effect in terms of, you know, there is less retained drug in the gut acting on the microorganisms.
So we actually, I mean, I haven't come across Indian studies or patient-based studies where the dose of a particular antibiotic determined the country of India. So all of these are basically based on researches happening out there in Europe or America, where the anthropology, I mean, the sizes, the dimension of each patient is different. And probably aren't we giving a little higher dose to our patients than what actually would be required in our patients? This is just a thought, for food for thought. I mean,
yes. if we, you know, in Indian studies, you know, there we have, you know, most of them have been, you know, focused on probiotics or, you know, those things only. But, you know, with respect to we can, you know, the research would be like if we come up with, you know, with formulations that is like which are easily absorbed or which can ensure maximum absorption, so that there would be, you know, less amount of drug that is retained in the gut, you know, which can affect these organisms. That is also, you know, that is one strategy. And there is also something called, you know, microbiome, which is, you know, coming up. So there are some research that is going on how we can you know, affect or introduce some changes in the genetic information of these commensal bacteria, which is present in the gut, that is called the microbiome. So that is, you know, the recent researchers are saying that these organisms can affect almost all physiological functions of our body. So there are some researchers going on, you know, in manipulating the genetic information of these organisms so that, you know, we can maximize the effectiveness, benefits of the drug and reducing the harmful effects, which is, you know, which one of which is the diarrhea or the gastrointestinal intolerance.
Thank you, Dr. Shukrat, as well as Dr. Rajan, for managing this despite a lot of network connectivity issues. Thank you very much. I now request our IDA Bangalore branch president, Dr. Satisha Reddy, to address the gathering, and then Dr. Sudarshan Sajan will give away the vote of thanks. Can we have Dr. Satisha sir online now? Satisha Reddy, I think
he is online. I feel there is again some internet issues.
There is some connectivity issues. Dr. Sudarshan is online, and I think he can hear me. Can you hear me, Dr. Sudarshan?
Yeah. Dr. Joshi, I can hear you.
To introduce Dr. Sudarshan Sajan is an eminent maxillofacial surgeon practicing in Bangalore and a professor of maxillofacial surgery in KLE College of Dental Sciences in on Tumkur Road in Bangalore. He is also a very active practitioner, and he is our beloved secretary of IDA Bangalore branch. I now request Dr. Sudarshan Sajan to give away the vote of thanks. Over to you, sir.
Thank you, Dr. Joshi. At the outset, I would like to start with one Veda sloka, anta asti prarambha. That means to say is that all good things come to an end, but friends, with every ending comes a new beginning. Very good evening to one and all participated today. I am Dr. Sudarshan, as Dr. Revan introduced me, and I take this opportunity as my privilege to extend the vote of thanks. Firstly, I would like to wish everyone who are participated today on this forum the National Dentist Day Wish you all happy National Dentist Day. As a secretary from IDEA Bangalore branch, I always see a nice activities going to come with our branch under the able guidance of our mentors who are there in our forum, like MC Sudhakar sir, Dr. MC Sudhakar sir, and our mentors in the senior practitioners who are there in IDEA. They all guide us to have a good, clinical activities or continuous dental education activities to be conducted, and we are in the same footstep. And we do also have very good Dr. Revan Joshi as our convener. And before I actually go into the concept of thanking everyone, I wished the National Dentist Day, and let me thank all the expert speakers today with their busy schedule. And it's an opt for our dental fraternity, knowing a medical concept in dental practice. And for that, for these medical problems which they actually face, today our speakers have made it very, simplified concept, like how to practice the medical, dentistry in a medical scenario or with the morbid conditions of dental patients, the Dento Medical Symposium. First of all, I would like to thank Dr. S. Venkatesh sir and Dr. Pawan Yadav sir and Dr. Sukrit sir, who have done a great presentation. And we are all really happy, sir, for giving such a wonderful session. And thank you very much for your time and the lecture. Now, secondly, I would like to thank our state branch office bearer, Dr. Sudhindar sir, president of our Karnataka state branch, and Dr. Shiv Prasad sir, honorable secretary of Karnataka IDA. As well, Dr. Ravi M. G., CD convener of Karnataka State Branch, who has always been with us and associating, guiding us for all the CD programs. Today also they have associated and guided us to conduct this beautiful Dento Medical Symposium. As well, very importantly, I would like to thank our KSDC president, Dr. Ranganath sir, who is also our guiding hand, helping hand and supporting hand in all the those IDEA activities, especially the CD activities, which where sir guide us in conducting a good number of CD programs. Thank you very much, sir, for your guidance always. And I would like to thank GSK Pharma and GSK Pharma, Mr. Rishabh, Mr. Ramana, Mr. Arun, for their active participation and active supporting for conducting the CD programs. So also, very importantly, I want to thank Dr. Roxanne Somil and Dr. Girish, who are actually dental reach personalities and will help us always in conducting the webinars. Thank you guys for your wonderful webinar support and all activity support, online activity support. And also, I would like to thank our very important rock star of this program, Dr. Revan Joshi. Without whom these type of programs are very difficult to conduct in our IDA, though we conducted, but still he is being a very active proponent of our IDA, and I hope he does still more better, still more number of programs in our IDA. And this is one of the best program, really, Dr. Revan Joshi, keep it up. And we are very happy to have you as a CD convener to IDA Bangalore branch. And also, I would like to thank all the participants today who have participated actively, and almost I can see some 100 participants are there, and they're all hope they have enjoyed. And without you people, this program would have not seen the light of the day. And thank you wholeheartedly from IDA. Thank you very much for being a part of this program. And thank you one and all who are supported for this program, and have a great day. Thank you very much, Dr. Evan.
Thank you very much, Dr. Sudarshan, for your taking over the responsibility of conveying the vote of thanks. That's the most important part of any event. I once again wholeheartedly thank Dr. Sudarshan Sajjan for supporting our activities in all the ways possible in IDA. And I also would like to thank all the office bearers and veterans and senior advisors of IDA Bangalore branch and Karnataka state branch, who have been always motivating us to provide the best what we can, and always motivate us to achieve the best. We are unfortunately unable to connect our president, Dr. Satisha Reddy, He has some issues with his network, I believe. I convey the thanks on his behalf to all of you who participated. And as I said, keep in touch with us to get the best out of us. So thank you one and all, and we can call it. Have a good weekend and enjoy practicing dentistry and spreading smiles to all the faces whom we can reach out to. All the best. God bless.